Hey everybody, we're having an early conversation for you today here at the TFP. If you don't know, I'm Leslie, and this is Leslie Jordan, a much, much cooler Leslie than this Leslie.
Hometown boy.
Hometown, and that's why you're here. Okay, tell us first how you have this Chattanooga connection. You grew up here, right?
Grew up in Chattanooga, went to Brainerd High School, and then I went away for a while.
A little bit.
Kind of come out of the closet, and who knows, I can't, it's all a blur.
You couldn't do that here back then?
No. But anyway, I came back, and I went to UTC and got a degree in theater. But as I left, the professor, Dr. Fred Behringer at the time, said, I cannot let you leave without teaching you to pronounce theater. It ain't theater.
Theater.
I'll go to New York City. I had a degree in theater, and I got on a bus. It's 1982.
Oh.
And down here, the old Greyhound bus. I don't think we could afford Greyhound. I think it was Trailways.
Okay, they still had buses back then. I mean, are there still Greyhounds out there?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So, Mama, I had raised $1,200 waiting tables at the old Vine Street Market down on campus.
Oh, cool.
And I got, Mother sewed it into my underpants, you know, just in case I got robbed. And we went, and I took a bus to Hollywood in 82. And I had a suitcase, $1,200 in the dream.
I love those stories. When they're true, I believe you.
Mine's true. And I, you kids will know IMDb, whatever, 380 programs.
Yeah.
And so, highlights, well.
Yeah, our reporter, Susan Pierce, here at the TFP, went to school with you or went to
church
with you?
Both.
Okay, so she wrote me notes all about you. I already knew some of it.
She witnessed, I've been baptized 14 times.
Oh.
Just never did take. But anyway.
Oh, yeah. I understand. Yeah. Okay, so when you first got to Hollywood in 82, and he still lives there. That's cool.
Yeah.
So you love it there. And
you
come back here, too, so you must like it a little bit. You like Chattanooga a little bit.
I love Chattanooga. It's okay. Funny, I spent the first 30 years of my life desperate to get out of here, not having anything to do with it. And the last 30 years, coming home, any...
And your mom is here?
My mom is here, my twin sisters.
Oh, cool.
Who don't have names. They're just sister and twin.
Those who don't want to be
talked
about. Okay.
No. It's that. They, I think one's Janet. I can't remember that other one.
Okay.
But they've just been sister and twin.
Yeah, I have a lot of siblings, too. I have no idea where they are. Hey, Dessa, Teresa, and Clark. Kidding. Okay. So let's get into it. Going to L.A., was it like immediate success, or what was it like?
I got there, and there was a very famous commercial for Wendy's Hamburgers where a lady named Clara Peller said, "Where's the beef?" And all of a sudden, the whole world was saying, "Where's the beef?"
Okay.
And I had that perfect white trash kind of look for what they wanted. I mean,
perfect.
You know, at the time, you had to look like you
in
the
Love
commercials.
You.
Okay. But I, they then wanted characters, and I started working nonstop. I was kind of like Flo from the,
Cool.
I mean, I was known, you know.
That's awesome.
And,
Well, you kind of have, like, a big personality.
But I, you know, they tried to time, you know, you couldn't be openly gay in Hollywood. It was the weirdest
thing. In 82, in the 80s.
Oh, it was so weird, because at night, you'd go to the clubs, you'd see every producer, every casting director, everybody. And then during the day, it was very wink-wink.
Yeah,
you know? And then my agent, who...
Gotta love those agents, right?
But he... I had been told the secret to Hollywood was to get a gay agent and a Jewish manager.
Yeah,
and then you
smart.
Got Hollywood sewn up.
Yeah.
So I got a Jewish... gay agent and a Jewish manager, but they would conspire, and they would call him to, she would say, she was very New York, she'd say, tell him keep his feet on the ground, you know, tell him keep his hands by his side, get that voice in the lower register, you know, this, so we couldn't, they had words for gay people. They would give a casting call, and they would ask for nebbish, which is an odd little word, nebbish.
Yeah.
Or they would say mama's boy was popular.
Oh,
or
nice.
Wink, wink, lighten the loafers, but, you know.
Yeah.
And so,
much different kinds of people there than Chattanooga. Because here, people are real subdued, and let's not talk about it back then. But here they were, that's an interesting tale. And it's changed so much.
And it has. And, you know, the gay character in Hollywood, I followed it. I mean, I was a part of it. Took the same journey as the African American character took. First, there was always a neighbor.
Right.
You know, there was a neighbor.
So you were allowed to be the neighbor.
And then they would come in with the zinger. You know, they could come in with the zinger.
Mm-hmm.
Then there were families. Until Cosby came along, it was usually kind of the lower socioeconomic. You know, so they could get all ghetto and carry on. Well, it was the same place with the gay people. The first gay I ever saw on TV, I mean, it was a TV show called Brothers. It was cable.
Talking about there was actually, a gay kiss on Star Trek. Was it Star Trek?
Yeah,
do you remember that?
I was on Star Trek. I was the Ferengi.
Oh, well.
They didn't give me a gay kiss. They said to me, because I can't drop my accent, really.
Yeah.
And so you can't have an alien.
Why not? You could now.
I was a Ferengi, and I walked onto the Enterprise and delivered my first line of director. It was called Deep South Nine.
Oh.
Or something.
Director
said, this ain't deep. No, Deep Space Nine.
Deep South Nine. That would be good.
The director said, it ain't Deep South Nine. Hit that Ferengi a little north of Mason-Dixon.
Oh.
And then it got embarrassing because they hired a linguist, and she said, Mr. Jordan, feather does not have four syllables.
Oh.
Feather.
Ah, hey.
Actually, feather.
I like it. It's good. So I got way off track, but we were just talking about that because I didn't know that and somebody had informed me. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. Something I didn't know. But anyway, so you saw this first gay character in a show maybe called Brothers. When do you think that was around?
God. 82.
82, okay.
You have to also understand, as a little boy, I would see the only queers that were Liberace, which never admitted till the day he died, but like somebody's going to blow her cover. But anyway, Liberace, and then there was Paul Lynn, the center, and then I saw Truman Capote on the Johnny Carson show.
Oh, wow.
And what I would see is this, you know, I fell out of the womb and landed in my mother's high heels. I mean,
right.
I've got the accent, and it's not just my, they go, is that Southern? No, honey, that's gay. It's called a sibilant S. And I would watch TV, and I'd get sick to my stomach because I'd have to leave the room because it was just so shameful to see that and begin to think, oh, my God. And the worst thing that kid could call you in school is, you know, you're a fag, you pussy, you queer.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was very popular.
Of course.
But it was because I was funny.
Yeah.
But it was to keep the bullies at bay.
And cute.
Cute, but I never knew it.
Aw, do you know now?
You know, I do kind of, but
that's
good. I look back and see myself around 20, and I was adorable. And I think that my self-esteem was such, I had nowhere for that to go.
I know, don't you wish we all could go back
and own that.
All you men listening.
Yeah.
Anyways, okay, so you're an outspoken gay activist, and we're going to talk about that, why you're here for this weekend's Chattanooga Cares, which is a great organization in Chattanooga. I've done tons of stories through the years with them. We're going to talk about that, but people want to hear about your career, too. First, we have questions.
We do have one question. What was the most fun part of American Horror Story?
Oh, yeah, everybody wants to talk about American
Horror Story.
We're going to have to get into that.
Lady Gaga.
Did you get to make out with her or something?
Well, it was her idea that before she killed me, she wanted to have sex with me.
I heard that.
And so I can't even say what she said, but she said, before I kill you, I want to blank you.
Get it, girl.
Malibu, 3 a.m, and I said, well, isn't that nice? Now we're going to put this past the director. She said something I'd never heard. She said, are you a gold star guy? And I said, She said, were you born cesarean? Did you come back? I said, well.
Yeah.
And she said, have you ever been near? Okay. I said, I was a hippie.
Well, this is
I mean, come on. Yes. And she said, oh, well. A gold star guy is a guy who's never been near.
Gotcha. I didn't know that. Thank you, Lady Gaga. I learned something from Lady Gaga today, everyone. And I hope you did, too.
And I was standing in a room with Kathy Bates.
Just Kathy Bates.
Cuba Gooding Jr., Angela Bassett, Sarah Paulson.
In this
Paulson.
New season, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking there's a lot of golden hardware. I mean, my little Emmy for Will and Grace
right.
is only best guest actor, not even presented at the Emmys.
Hey, it's still something.
Yes. But I thought I'm holding my own here.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's amazing.
And Cuba calls me my baby. I'm his baby boy. And wants to hug my
baby.
Neck and kiss
oh.
on me. And,
oh, sounds
but,
good.
Yeah, but no. It's and so the.
So you've been in how many seasons of American Horror Story now?
I did the third
you
season, which was
Lady
called
Gaga.
Cuba.
So that was Hotel, right?
No,
that's
that? Right now.
That was right now?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I need to catch up.
Yeah,
so do y'all.
And it happens so fast you won't quite get it.
Oh, great.
She blinds me.
Okay.
And then kicks me in my stomach, pokes me with a stick.
I guess you'll take anything from Lady Gaga. So that's this season, Roanoke, right?
My Roanoke. I did Coven, and then I was offered...
Love Coven.
I was offered Freak Show the next season.
And you weren't in Hotel?
No.
They all run together.
But, you
They're
know, Freak Show I wanted to do, but I was broke.
Oh.
And I was offered, because Will and Grace is so popular...
Yeah.
...overseas, they said...
Oh, still...
Yeah, they okay. said, do you want to do a reality show in London? I said, what? Yeah, I don't want to. They said, well, it's called Celebrity Big Brother. I said, oh, no. They're going to lock me in the house. And then they said, Leslie, the initial offer is £150,000. That's
oh, okay.
about $300,000.
You're like, I'm there.
I said, book me. So yeah. I went and
you got locked in a house in London.
And spit on Gary Busey.
Oh, how's he doing?
He's
awful.
He's
a little crazy.
But you know what? It's not crazy. It's
just like he has issues.
No, he's gone. There's
he's gone.
And it's his hygiene. Like someone needs to tell him, you know, Gary, clean your bottom after you. And if you do it onto the top of
right.
the sink of the. If you, poo,
you guys are good friends, huh?
I spit on him.
Yeah.
I spit on him. It was the most disgusting thing. Of course, they cut his hygiene. Just imagine real fast. Not even near. I'm talking about a tiny room. 14 people.
No.
Two bathrooms.
No, I don't want to.
Seven beds.
No, thanks. No. We're not doing that.
Toenails like Howard Hughes. He barred me. I said, Gary, this is disgusting. Stinks.
How long were you there?
It
sounds like it may have traumatized you.
I lasted my unfortunate incarceration, which was my second. I've been.
Oh.
You got to buy the book.
It's all right.
I was in Robert Downey Jr., 152 Paw Day, cell 13.
Oh,
he
I
was
mean,
top, I was bottom.
Good company.
That is. I lasted 12 days.
Okay. So you.
So I didn't do Freak Show, so I thought I'd messed up with Mr. Murphy, Ryan
oh,
Murphy.
Yeah. Just him.
And I've never met... I met him for the first time the other day, and he... Apparently, I'm the new fan favorite, and he said, I am... My goal is to get you back on TV.
Yeah.
I said, I know I left.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, it seems like you've been a little bit of everywhere.
And that's good, because the ups and the downs and...
Well, that's what happens, right?
And these kids, you have to tell them, one TV series doth not a career make.
No.
And it's a tiny town, and if you misbehave, what happens around the casting table? All somebody has to say is, life is too short, and you're done.
Yeah.
Nobody will put up with that anymore.
So they like a character like you, but they don't like a Lindsay Lohan behavior type going on.
No.
We get that. Well, I want to go over some of the other stuff that you've done, because there's the list is so long.
And
okay,
we do have one
more
question.
American Horror Story questions.
It was a what's it like working with Kathy Bates question.
Kathy is, gosh, should I say this? She's deaf. completely
different. Oh, yes. That's like we speak loud here.
She is completely deaf in this ear, and she's a hearing aid.
Oh.
But does it affect her acting? Absolutely not. She won't wear a hearing aid. But she would say to me, now, when you're off camera, and, you know, it's 3 or 4 in the morning. We work from 6 at night to 6 in the morning.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
In the woods. And so she said, you have to yell your off-camera lines. And she does her thing. She just spray it. And then I'm like,
whatever Kathy Bates
wants. What are you yelling? I said, she told me to.
I would yell.
But then, I don't think it comes better than I followed her from.
So she's one of the best.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Kathy Bates and Cuba, Angela.
Sarah Paulson is super impressive, too. Yeah. She's a gay woman, right?
She's lesbian, and her girlfriend is the mother of 2.5 men.
Yes.
There's like a 30 or 40 year age difference.
Tell me her. Holland Taylor. Yeah, see, I know. I'm into it, ladies. But, she's been a super impressive character actress. You know, like, kind of like you, your personality is a little, maybe a little bit bigger, but you recognize her sometimes, but you're not sure from where. So that's...
She's also a writer like me.
Yeah.
She wrote a one-woman show on Ann Richards, who's my favorite. She was governor of Texas, and her best line, I don't know that this was in Holland's, she was such a drunk, she was sober for many years, but she'd go into a bar, and she was dead serious. Ann Richards would say, honey, I'd like a bottle of vodka and a floor plan.
Oh.
She wanted to know, how's she going to get out?
That's a good question.
I need a bottle of bourbon and a floor plan.
You going to use that next time, Shaquille? Just kidding. Maybe not. Okay, I want to tell you all young folks who have just been watching American Horror Story. There's a show. You've been in 70 sitcoms and dramas. Does that sound right? That's what Susan tells us. And Murphy Brown, of course, I loved it. If you haven't watched it, if you're like 20-something, it's a great show. Maybe it's on Netflix, but it was about a woman reporter, strong woman, single mom. And she also had, you know, this painter guy and always had a secretary. So you were one of...
I was the first one.
Yeah, so she always had like
a
different...
season, fourth episode, pilot season.
It was a really good show.
And Candace Bergen is Hollywood royalty. And I'm from the South, I would call her ma'am.
And she had a background, and I think in politics and reporting and stuff, maybe before.
Yes, her daddy was Edgar Bergen, so she's Hollywood royalty. But I saw her. I worked with her many years later on Boston Legal.
Okay.
And she looked better.
Oh.
And I said, "How's your little girl?" She said, "A junior at Brown."
Oh.
And so I thought, no.
How did that
happen?
So
we were in the dressing room, and what they like to do in the makeup trailer. Comb her hair.
Oh, I know.
And then throw it.
We know.
And so they had her forward, and I motioned to the hairdresser. I wanted to see if there weren't.
No.
I wanted to see
marks.
Scars.
No. Maybe she's...
Yeah, Murphy Brown was That was the bride.
Yeah, it was great. So, yeah, I teach a college class, and they told me all about your role in American Horror Story last night. They knew all about it. They were like, this is what happened to his character last night. We're not going to say. But, yeah, my college kids at Chat State, thanks, Sam. But I would love for kids who are experiencing you now to, like, look back.
Reba McIntyre's show, probably best known for Ally McBeal.
Ally McBeal.
I was Josh Groban's, an unknown kid named Josh Groban. And somebody had heard him, Mr. Kelly, David Kelly, had heard him sing at an event. We brought him in, and I was his choir teacher, and he's suing his girlfriend because she won't go to the, she decided not to go to the prom with him.
I forgot he was
such a great episode. And so he's just such an awkward kid. And I'm his choir teacher, and I said, "Miss McBeal, she goes, you cannot sue." And I said, "Miss McBeal, have you ever had your heart broken?" She said, "Okay, let's go." So we were sort of laughed out of court. But she finally says to him, "Would you like to take an older woman to your prom?"
Oh, I remember.
And then he sings. And
his voice is amazing.
This little awkward kid, in real life, awkward, began to sing and just... He told me, he said, "You know, I was 14 years old, very conservative, family, Hancock Park, and no music. And this is Josh Groban speaking.
Amazing.
He said, I joined the choir and I opened my mouth and Barbara Streisand came out. It was just a voice like...
So you got to know him. You've gotten to know so many people. Yeah. How was Calista Flockhart? Was she...
Calista's an odd little bird.
Odd can be good.
She's not... She
not warm and friendly?
The closest I got was so silly. She said, your accent's adorable. Where are you from? I said, Tennessee. She said, my parents live in Tennessee. Well, what would the next thing you'd obviously say?
Where?
I said, where? And she said...
Top secret?
She said, can you excuse me for a minute?
Oh,
and
weird.
I thought, you know what?
Oh, so important.
It was conversation, but you know, yeah. She.
Now, sometimes you do meet these celebrities and he's cool, he's genuine, he's real, this is you. But you meet some of them, you're so excited to meet them and interview them and they're icy. And then when the camera turns off, they'll turn it on and be nice. And then right when it's off, they're back to being icy. So he's not like that. But I've unfortunately encountered some
Calista's
of that. And
Calista's probably not.
Maybe it was a bad day.
It was also, we had Robert Downey Jr., who I'd been imprisoned with.
Oh. Well, tell me he's great. Tell me he's great. Terrible. Okay, good.
We were in jail together. We told my mother, I was at Betty Forward, and mother said, that's so loud. Real loud out there, Betty Forward. We'd been in jail. But anyway, Calista was having to deal, and Robert was not well.
Okay, yeah, well, maybe you'll give her a break. I have one too. Carly Boehm, hey Carly, says, ask LJ to bring hysterical blindness to Chattanooga. What's that? Tell me what that is.
I wrote a one-man show about my mom, who ended up at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, with hysterical blindness. She shut her eyes and didn't open them for 2 years. You know, she just had enough. And so I wrote a play about it, and I just wanted to showcase myself in L.A., and it just took off.
Oh,
it went off Broadway.
Wow.
It went to the West End of London. So
Carly wants you to bring it here. Is there a chance that could ever...
Carly, it will never happen, and it's because my mother...
She doesn't want it here.
Here's what she said to me. Leslie Allen, if I live to be 105, I will never understand this deep-seated need you have to air our dirty laundry. Why can't you just whisper it to a therapist?
It helps people. Tell her it helps people.
I know, but it's still her story.
Yeah,
she's the most private person I know.
Okay, so... Is it going to be anywhere else ever, maybe, potentially?
Hysterical blindness won't. I'm working right now on a sequel to that.
Oh, she's crying. Emoji crying.
Well, listen, watch for Church, A Spirited Revival, which is the sequel to that. And we're doing a reading in February called A Backer's Audition. And I'm pretty sure that I have Megan Mullally.
Oh, cool.
It'll be our reunion. My dream cast is at her, Allison Janney, Kristen Chenoweth, Cheyenne Jackson, to try to raise the money. And I have Sir Anthony Watson, former CEO of Barclays.
Oh,
and then he left for a little company called Nike. Now he's loose in Hollywood. He's
loose.
Young and gay and handsome.
The best kind.
And he's got about $30 billion of the Saudis' money. And so
looking for this. Tell me what it's called again.
Church.
For Carly.
Church, A Spirited Revival.
And she said we do need to stop all the whispering in Chattanooga. So she feels like...
Oh, I thought you meant between us.
Yeah. All right. So tell us, speaking about that, thanks, Carly. And you had another question real quick, but I do want to get into the Chattanooga Cares thing. So let's take the question real quick, and then we're going to talk about Chattanooga Cares.
He started to talk about Reba a little bit, and somebody asked, Wesley Brewer asked, how was it repeatedly guest and co-starring on shows like Reba?
You come in and you're the odd guy out, and the only bad experience I've ever had was, and it's terrible to judge her for this, but if your name is Ellen and a show is called Ellen, your sitcom, you're the host, you know, and I'm your guest, and you should greet me.
Yeah.
At least make me feel welcome. Now,
Did I do that?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. Okay. And most do. And Reba.
Uh-huh. Didn't.
No. No, Reba did.
Oh, she did. Okay.
I'm saying that you, in other words, it's her show. And Reba is the only show that I've ever done where there was a prayer circle.
Oh.
She would say, let's, and she, you know, she's devout.
Okay.
Devout Christian, but she would say, let's go to our respective gods. And then the one that played her husband, hammering that beer, a long one, so does. Reba preaches like an old-timey preacher. A lot of these, and oh Lord, we come to thee with our talents. And
oh, she goes on. I had no idea. Okay.
She goes on and on, and we're holding hands. And what's his name? Plays her husband. He would.
Was it?
He'd go like this. He'd hold me. He'd go. Oh yes. Oh yes.
He has lots of stories, you guys. I could keep him here all day.
We got to get this.
Okay, Chattanooga Cares. It's important. Let's talk about this. Arts for Cares this Saturday, 7 p.m. Ava, awesome gallery on the North Shore. Tickets are $100. Live and silent auctions, ballet, Tennessee performance, and
me,
Leslie Jordan.
Tequila tasting.
Yeah,
but now I'm not me.
Okay.
I've not had a drink in 20 years.
Oh, really?
Since my unfortunate incarceration.
Right.
The first one.
Well,
but let me tell you real fast, Chattanooga Cares.
Yes. Where are you part of this?
Well, I'm a gay man who got off the bus in 82 and found West Hollywood, and it was a city in crises. And I buried, and I'm not making this up to be dramatic, an entire phone directory. Just checked off the names, and we went to memorial services. And so, you know, that's my ministry, you know. And so anytime that Chattanooga Cares, we did a show at the Tivoli, mm-hmm. which I could have sworn was Hysterical Blindness. I can't remember. No, that's My Trip Down the Pink Carpet. I did some.
His book is My Trip Down the Pink Carpet, right?
Right. And that was a show. And then my show right now is called Straight Out of Chattanooga because I live in Tupac's old apartment.
In L.A. And we lived like near each other in
and
Hollywood.
I'm a thug and a rebel. And Google Leslie Jordan Starbucks. You'll get 10 cop cars and TMZ. I threw my, wasn't coffee. Hot coffee, as TMZ said. It was sweet iced tea on a boy that called me a faggot. But anyway.
Right, they have sweet tea in Hollywood now?
Yeah. Well,
new. All right.
Starbucks.
Oh, cool. Okay.
So, Chattanooga Cares is, as you can imagine, still, we were leaving the WGOW mm-hmm. a minute ago.
Yeah.
Our Mitzi.
Who did you talk to?
Our Mitz.
Guy or girl?
Kevin. Kevin?
Brian? Joyce?
No. The Tennessee Triumph. It's a girl. No.
Okay. Yeah. He was at WGA.
Oh, God.
You're fine.
But we were leaving in the...
Well, don't forget Leslie.
I remember Tennessee Triumph. No, no, no.
No.
Florida Triumph. No, no, no. And Mitzi, it was kind of awkward because the cops were there. I thought, oh, God, here we go again.
Uh-oh.
But they were so friendly, and I thanked them for their service. And but Mitzi immediately said, guys, you cannot get HIV from spit. And when you go on the air and say that you needed a spit mask,
oh my God,
we've got to talk. And so it was just, I thought, God, it's still
that is that happened.
I don't know what it was about. It was an accident.
That is ridiculous.
Well, and I'm not putting it's, you know, it's very difficult right now to be in law enforcement, but. Anyway, she said, guys, I got to educate you. And they were like, yeah, yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. Okay, so.
Oh, Janet Williams is the Tennessee Tramp. Thank you, Carla. Thank you.
Janet.
Somebody really likes you.
They just interviewed me. Oh,
we got it.
God.
It's good. They won't watch. It's fine.
But Chattanooga Cares, and they called and said, is he available? And I said, I'm circling the block, but I got to have a plane ticket. That's all I want. And it's got to be up front. It's got to be front. I don't go in steerage. And so they had a board meeting and flew me in.
And good, good. And you've done a lot of work here for this cause, right?
Yeah.
So you'll continue to come back and it obviously makes sense what you told us about losing all these people early on. Have you seen, since working in AIDS activism, a difference, you know, and what has changed?
The thing that has changed is it's not on the red ribbons are not on the red carpet. You know, we've moved mm-hmm. on. It's not the disease of the moment. And right. so, and I think kids today, especially even educated gay kids, think that it's manageable. So mm-hmm. if I get it, you know, well, I had a friend who would go to high schools and say, yeah, it's manageable. And he would pull out this one out and says, this one causes me to poop myself, sometimes in public. This one has to be taken at 2 a.m., period.
Yeah.
Violently.
Scary.
And so to show people, and Mitzi had a wonderful story with the young girl who's scared to death of getting pregnant. Mm-hmm. But she said, well, you know, there's STDs, too. She said, what? I'm scared of getting pregnant. Yeah, but honey, to get pregnant, you're obviously, if you're scared, then you're probably not using condoms. And there's a lot of other stuff out
yeah.
there. Getting pregnant might be the least of your problems, honey. Mm-hmm.
So it's still, yeah, I hear you. We still need to talk about it.
And, you know, we've also moved on to, it's nowhere as it was in the beginning, from the gay community, you know, you have HIV, drug use. I mean, anybody. So...
Yeah, well, it's important to keep talking about it. So, I thank you. This has been fun. He's a busy man, an interesting man. I wish I could hang out with you this weekend.
You have to watch for my next movie, which is called...
I'm watching.
It's called A Very Sordid Wedding, and I play a man in the mental hospital who thinks he's Tammy Wynette, but I've escaped, and I've gone on the lam with a serial killer.
Have you already filmed it?
Yeah, we shot in Winnipeg. And Whoopi Goldberg.
Crazy.
Whoopi Goldberg. Who's kind of lazy and smokes a lot of dope.
Smokes, yeah. Well, that would make you lazy.
She won't get on a plane.
That would make you lazy.
She's scared to get on a plane. Okay. We had to send a tour bus to go get her.
Really?
25 hours.
I love all
drivers.
These stories.
She shot her. I said, Whoopi, I was in drag. I told everyone it. And comedy is not pretty.
Uh-huh.
You should go online and look up Brother Boy.
Oh.
So go look at Brother Boy, because it's a sequel to a movie I did 20 years ago with Olivia Newton-John.
But, was she cool?
Yeah.
Oh, I love her. Beautiful.
But Whoopi, I said, hey, Whoopi, you remember me? She goes, I said, I've been on The View 3 times.
Oh, she doesn't remember.
She goes, I don't remember.
She's smoking too much.
I said, I was with Lily Tomlin. She's a comedic. She goes,
no.
I don't remember. So I sat there a while and I thought, this is inexcusable. I went over and I said, Whoopi, she goes, I don't remember you.
Oh, it's nice. Well, at least, are you okay with her? She's okay.
Oh,
I
want to hug her neck. When you see this movie.
Oh. Okay, tell me the name of that movie again.
A Very Sordid Wedding.
With very sordid folks.
So a black comedy about white trash.
Love it. Perfect. When is that? When can we expect that?
That'll
next?
Come out in February. Miss Rosine Supple, the richest woman in Palm Springs, and you got to be real rich to be. Gave us the money, and we gave her. She owns a little chain of theaters called Camelot.
Okay.
That they'll get it in February, and then it'll be released.
And you can watch American Horror Story Roanoke with your buddy Cuba Gooding Jr., who sounds really nice.
Yes, he calls me a baby boy and hugs my neck.
Can I come?
Yeah.
Okay, tell everybody when you can watch that on FX, right?
It's on 10 o'clock on FX, but I've been murdered, so don't tune
Wednesday
in.
Wednesday nights.
Yeah, Wednesday nights, but you want to see...
You're not supposed to tell people that.
I know, but you want to watch my Roanoke Nightmare on episode 3 and 4.
Okay.
People want to know how to get tickets to the event this weekend.
Okay.
Oh, you should probably call Ava, I would think, or Chattanooga Cares. I'm just saying. Yeah, they can call Chattanooga Cares. It's called Art for Cares, or call Ava Gallery.
Who's Ava?
It's the gallery. So I'm sure they probably have tickets or.
And listen, don't let that $100 scare you, because it's
not scary.
Tax deductible. And I did another thing for the Chattanooga Little Theater, and I was so disappointed none of my friends came. And they said, Leslie, it was $175. So just scrape it up.
It's for a good cause.
It's for a really good cause. And
with stuff like that, I always tell people, you have to think the money isn't going toward what you're eating or what you're drinking. It's going toward the cause.
Yeah.
So I try to, I used to work in nonprofits, but, you know, it's true. You're not paying for your
And
your
I can't
comp.
I wish I could comp. I could comp every one of them.
Oh, yeah.
But it can't.
Yeah. So if you can, tax deductible, and he is worth talking to, worth meeting. Another Leslie. So anything else you want
to... I forgot to put my jacket on. I had a real nice
We're real
jacket.
Casual up in here. Okay. Did you like this kind of Facebook Live situation?
Yeah.
Yeah, we match. The Leslies are wearing blue today.
Yeah.
Thought you'd like it.
Okay.
Okay.
I gotta get over here.
Okay, yeah. Well, this wasn't this more fun than the normal TV stations? Come on.
Here,
it was.
This is Mitzi. Oh. 1 second. Sweetheart, where did they get the tickets? Arts.
The number four.
Arts for care.
Arts, the number four. Care or cares? Cares. Cares. Okay.
Arts for, F-O-U-R. F.
We'll put it on the website.
Oh, okay. That's her
Let
number.
Me. She got it?
Yeah.
Mitzi?
I'm so sorry.
Okay, so it's arts, the number four, cares, and then what? .com? .org. Okay, so you guys, will link that for you. You got it?
It's in the comment section.
Okay, cool. We have it in the comment section. Well, it sounds fun. I have a fundraiser for my kid's school that night, but... Yeah, I know, Montessori. But maybe I'll stop by. That'd be fun. Oh, they did? Yeah.
We still aren't going.
Yeah, I love it. Oh, we love Jed Mescon. Oh, fun. We're just going off. Oh, Leslie! Okay, we gotta go. Okay, bye.